we were able to, yes, good morning to everybody again. Today we are able to use Zoom, and now I started with the recording as well. Yes, let me just maybe tell some words at the beginning of our session today. Now Aitor is also coming. Good morning, Aitor. Aitor Blanco, good morning. Yes, let me just say a few words about the conference at the beginning. I don't want to bore you early in the morning. Everybody's just sort of waking up. Between Greece and Turkey, there is only 1 hour. And I think with Serbia, we have 2 hours. This is what Mariana says yesterday. And with Italy, I think two.
It's the same, yes, with it.
Yeah, with Aitor, I think 3, I guess, with Spain. So with Portugal, this will be 4. Because between Portugal and Spain, there is always one. So this will go and go and go. So anyways.
Good morning.
Good morning, Aitor.
Good morning.
So good morning. Thank you very much. You're welcome. And hi. Good morning. So I just want to say, some technical things. We are few people. I don't know if this is good or bad. We will see. We are almost like 10 or to 15, but sometimes maybe we will be lucky to have 20 people. And as you see very well from the program, it's a very small program, but I'm so glad Mariana is with us, because she will be the one who will really judge about if we are doing something good or bad, if we are on the right path, if we are doing something right or wrong. So it's very important to have her. I don't want to bore you with my technical things. Maybe I should ask you if you have any questions right now, because Maria has already asked some questions. Just ask me now so that we will do a better recording and we will do a better workshop together. We will work out in a better way together. Your suggestions, your questions, just feel free to ask.
Just ask about the time, because I have to, to look after the schedule.
Yes.
But you told me that we're not very, very strict. We can be, a little bit open to.
Yes, because I'll be, hopefully, inshallah, I'll be speaking less, less than I estimated. I don't need to speak, because this is our conference anyways. So I'll be speaking less, so the rest of the people can have like 5 to 10 more minutes, Paolo and Aitor, because, maybe they will need some more.
If everybody has 10 minutes, there are 7 speakers, 6, 7.
Yes.
So we're going to be in the afternoon.
But yes, you can cut from my 10 or 5 minutes.
Okay.
But as I said, you're the boss, so just feel free.
I don't like me.
Just feel free.
I hate being the boss.
Just feel free to
coordinator, of course. Yes, with
Maria,
pleasure.
Yeah, that's very kind. Thank you very much, Maria. Just feel free to give some more time to them, and then also feel free to give some time for discussions if there is any question, any urgent question. You know, it depends on you.
Do you want the questions to be after each presentation or after the each paper, or we have a discussion by in the end?
Yes. What will the other participants tell about this? Mariana, Aitor, and Paolo, what would you say?
I think the idea was to do the discussion in the end.
At the end.
Okay.
Yes.
Nice. Okay. Thank you.
Good.
Yeah,
well,
it's a good idea.
But it's okay with me. We do it right away.
Any urgent question, sort of emergency questions.
Okay.
If there is any emergency questions, yes. If not, then you should wait until the end.
Okay.
And in my case, I prepare like more or less 15, 20 minutes, and like as if there were any questions afterwards. Yeah. But I'm okay, of course, with that. I mean, depending on the focus.
But if we spend about half an hour for each paper, then you have 7 papers, and 7 papers for 30 minutes. We are going to finish in the 6 in the afternoon, and anybody who wants to follow will miss the the next or the following or the third or the fourth, perhaps somebody wants to get on the, you know, the meeting about 12 o'clock or is working or something, we have to follow a little bit. So if there is an urgent question, we have the discussion.
Very good idea.
In the, I will try to keep this the schedule, I think.
Yes.
But with some the exceptions that you already mentioned, Ergun. Okay.
Yes, thank you very much, Maria. This is very reasonable. So if there is any other questions, then I would propose to everybody to rest a little bit if you want. Or just if you have any question, just write in the chat or whatever you want. Because we'll be starting with Maria's first session at 10 o'clock. So we have 25 or 23 minutes until we start. So we have a good time for coffee, if you wish, of course. Okay.
Fine. See you in a quarter of an hour or 10 minutes.
Yes. All right. Thank you very much. Very supportive. So. Ja, ich habe ihn gern gesehen. Hi, Maria. Would you like to chair the session right now, Maria? Maria, I think there is a problem with your sound. You were just speaking, but something happened. I have no idea. we can't hear you.
Is it better now?
Now, perfect.
Okay.
Very good.
Okay. I have.
Very good.
I have forgotten. Okay.
Athenian sound.
Yeah. Okay. So. I have to mute my micro because there is some works in the next apartment, so the sound is not very good.
Yes, Maria. I think there is a little problem with the connection. Maybe just to keep our schedule. Yes, would you like to maybe perhaps present our first session opening lecture?
Yes.
Would it be on?
Yeah. So we'll have, I'm sorry for the, you know, the sound. The opening lecture begins now, the Conférence d'ouverture. With Paolo Di Benedetto, Università degli Studi di Napoli, and della Basilicata in Potenza in Italy. And the title of the paper, of the presentation, is Asio en Limeni, Caistrio Amphirethra from Iliad, the image of Caistor River in the historical sources. Please, Professor Benedetto, you have the digital floor.
Good morning to everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Now I'm going to share my presentation. Just a moment. Okay. Can you tell me if you are able to see it?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I would like to thank the Department of Archaeology of Dokuz Eylül Üniversitesi of Izmir, as well as the organizing committee and especially Professor Ergun Lafleur for giving me this opportunity to attend this interesting conference and for making me to participate as a member of the scientific committee. It is a conference which in its intention aims to be a harbinger of new research perspectives and new contributions to be able to know and investigate the southern area of Izmir, with a particular focus on the valley of the Caister River, which today flows in this area with the name of Küçük Menderes. Before getting to the heart of the topics of this conference, it seems appropriate to trace a short study history about the Caister. We immediately noticed the non-systematic nature of the investigations and the absence of a volume exclusively dedicated to it, which this conference aims to do. The research that will be collected in these 2 days of study will include the most recent archaeological discoveries and historical investigation carried out about this region. The intent is to present the state of research on the Kaiser Valley from the Chalcolithic period to the end of the Ottoman Empire. The first scientific, just a moment, okay. The first scientific contribution dates back to the study of Ludwig Büchner, who wrote the first entry in Real Encyclopédie in 1921. This was followed by a series of contributions focused on the analysis of the landscape and the surrounding area of Ephesus in relation to the Caister and the geo-environmental problems linked to it, among which we can mention Cleve Foss, Ilan Kayan, John Kraft, Helmut Bruckner, Peter Scherer, and Recep Melich, Mariana Riekel, François Kibler, another article. The Kaiser Valley basically consists of the stretch that connects Izmir to ancient Ephesus, today located in the district of Seljuk. It was in history one of the most important centers for ancient civilizations, from the first Ionian Aeolian settlements up to the dark ages of the Persian and Arabian invasions. From a geological and anthropic point of view, the Kaiser Valley is one of the oldest inhabited areas of Asia Minor, together with the plains of the Caicos and Hermos rivers farther north. All these areas have been affected by the early settlement of people since what we mythically call the Trojan War. So let's get now to my contribution. Studying the Kaiser and its valley is methodologically difficult, both in the field of topography and in a more properly historical field. In particular, it is necessary to take into consideration several factors, such as irregularities and continuous hydrological modifications of the river's course due to progradation phenomena by which it has been affected over the centuries and which have radically altered the morphology of the surrounding territory. Historical sources allow us to partly reconstruct the events and functions that the river had for the ancients. The Greeks already had knowledge of it since the mythical time of the Trojan War, which can provide a starting point for the history of the Kaiser itself. And a term of comparison with the other types of sources that have come down to us. In this paper, I will try to offer a presentation of the Kaiser based on historical data and literary testimonies in order to understand how the Kaiser was represented and perceived in antiquity. In this analysis, geoarchaeological and historical geography research will be taken into account, at least in general terms and in the results achieved, in order to understand how over the centuries the river has changed its course concomitantly with anthropic changes, as well as climatic and environmental changes, as well as the topography. Taking into account the fact that this is a topic that I have approached in recent times, the speech I will give today has no claim to exhaustiveness. The most representative testimonies on the Kaiser will be taken into consideration. So let's begin the examination of literary documentation, taking into account the testimony of Stephanus of Byzantium, or better, the epitomator of his work, the Ethnica. We can see Kaistrion, plain in the region of Ephesus, named after the river Kaister, which was so named because it is located near the Katakikaumene region. This notice is accompanied by what the Pseudo-Herodian and Suda lexicon report. Kaister River, so-called because it is in the area near the Barents region. And Suida, Kaister, it's a river. So Stephanus of Byzantium attributes the Kaister Valley to the surroundings area of Ephesus, noting that the Kaister, the river from which this valley takes its name, was so-called because of its proximity to the so-called burnt region. Pseudo Herodian and also collects this tradition. This is a fact that we will return on shortly. The Kaister, ancient Kaustros in Greek sources and Kaistros in Latin ones, today is called Küçük Menderes in Turkish, literally small meander, and it is mainly meshly. It is a river located about 70 kilometers to south of the city of Izmir, which flows westwards and flows into the Aegean Sea at Pamukçak Beach near Selçuk. The Küçük Menderes is one of the most important rivers in Western Anatolia. From a geomorphological point of view, its valley consists of two parts. The upper part of plain of the internal valley, which constitutes an ancient structural geological unity formed by crystalline rocks and belonging to subsequent geological eras as Paleozoic and Mesozoic. The most recent tectonic movements of the underlying faults have created several depressions, including the Küçük Menderes. And the lower coastal part, or Seljuk-Ephesus Plain, which originated following the annexation of the internal depression in an east-west direction towards the coast. This second part is the one that interests us most closely. In the current state of its geomorphological conformation, the Küçük Menderes no longer has the features of a river, as in ancient times and partly in the modern age, but seems to have shrunk to the size of a stream. In fact, it measures only 130 kilometers from its source, located on Mount Molos, in a valley that in ancient times was known as Kaustianon Pedion. For convenience of exposition, we will continue to define it as a river in accordance with the ancient tradition. Thus, the river currently flows just north of the Büyük Menderes River, literally Great Meander. The naming is suggestive and indicates an environmental change. The names of the two rivers are in contrast to each other. For the discussion, we will address, in addition to this naming data, it is appropriate to say right away that both rivers, in particular the one that interests us, have often changed their course following various environmental and geological changes. The irregularity of the river flow, which alternated with periods of flood and dryness, has always constituted a problem for the surrounding communities. If, on one hand, the valley contributed to supplying the cities with water, on the other, the river allowed prosperous agriculture and the development of cane and hemp, useful for fabrics, and even episodes of overflow caused by floods were beneficial for the valley's soil. The most important transformation, as also in the case of the Hermos and the Scamander, is the progression of the river delta. Without going too far into the complex question, it will suffice to say that according to the most recent studies and the geoarchaeological reconstructions, this phenomenon began approximately before the Bronze Age and progressed slowly in the Archaic and Classical era, while in a more glaring way in the Hellenistic Age, particularly between 300 and 100 BC. In Roman times, however, the speed of progression decreased, and from around 700 AD, the coast remained unchanged. The last modification was essentially due to the construction of a canal in 1934. The testimony of Pliny the Elder applies to all who reports the inconvenience caused by the large quantity of mud, whose deposit caused an advance of the coastline. So let's read the text of Pliny the Elder. Ephesus is washed by the Caister, which springs from the fields of the Sibians and carries the waters of many streams downstream. From the waters comes a large quantity of mud that widens the coastline. The history of Caister is linked to that of Ephesus, a city located at the north of its river valley, to the point that both would have formed a single territorial district. A strategos in the time of King Eumenes, between 197 and 159 BC, is described as a strategist of Ephesus and the Caister Valley, who administered the so-called Castrianon Pedion, as we can see from this inscription. We can see the Caustru Pedium. Ancient Ephesus was in fact once an important port on this river, but over the centuries, sediment gradually filled the inlet around the city, so that the coastline shifted towards the sea and the ruins on Ephesus, which are located in the territory of the modern district town of Seljuk, are now about 8 kilometers from the coast. The ancient port of Panormus was near its mouth. The territory of Ephesus essentially covered a large part of the Caister Valley for several tens of kilometers and its slopes. The area of the Caister Valley, which lies between Sardis and Ephesus, was in use even before the period of Persian domination in Asia Minor, and would then be occupied by the Athenians when they attacked Sardis in 419 BC in the Ionian Revolt. An event of great importance, which marks a watershed in the history of Ephesus and Caister, was the refoundation of the city with the name of Arsinoe by Lysimachus in 294 BC, whose objective was to create a larger city. The real reason for this reconstruction would have been the difficult situation of the port in the classical era. Shortly after its refoundation, the city was hit by a flood of Caister, just when the Diadochus has attempted to move the population from the alluvial area around the Artemision. Strabo gives us the account of a disaster. Lysimachus then, after founding the present city, as the inhabitants who would gladly move, having observed the heavy rain, also helped to close the canals so that the city would be flooded. The inhabitants willingly moved. He named the city Arsinoe after his wife, but nevertheless, the ancient name prevailed. In another section of Stephanus of Byzantium, he says, the city, which had been built on a depressed site, was flooded by a storm, and Lysimachus, as thousands of inhabitants died, moved the city to the place where it stands now and named it Arsinoe in honor of his wife Arsinoe. But after she died, the previous name was resumed. So Strabo and Stephanus provide an isolated example that has survived our time of the disaster of the 3rd century BC. There would be reason to believe, according to historians, that the refoundation of the city of a new site by Lysimachus put an end, at least temporarily, to the type of the disaster. The continuous flooding process contributed to changing the shape of the coast, particularly in the port area. Attalus II tried to limit this dangerous process by building a dam, but by doing so, the king accelerated the sedimentation. Let's read what Strabo says. The city has an arsenal and a harbor. The engineers made the harbor entrance narrower, having been deceived by the king who had ordered them to do so. This was Attalus Philadelphus, for believing that the entrance would be deep enough for large merchant ships, and the harbor itself was already marshy due to alluvial deposits from the Caesar, he ordered a dam to be built at the mouth, which was very wide. Instead, the opposite happened. In fact, the silt dammed up of the inside caused the entire harbor to sink to the mouth. A similar intervention, but completely beneficial for the area, was also prepared by the Emperor Adrian, who dredged the port in 129 AD after a turbulent devastation by the Caesar River, as demonstrated by an epigraph. From the text, we understand how the emperor, hailed as founder and savior, made the port of Ephesus navigable and dammed the river. Over the centuries, therefore, the river created a relatively small valley in relation to the size of Ephesus, but densely populated. The dynamics linked to the role of the river in the area and the surrounding region are closely related to the change in the landscape and the progression of the river delta, which began to appear in a stoppable way and gradual manner, starting from the Bronze Age. The historical importance of these changings must not be underestimated, but must be contextualized within the historical framework of reference. Caesar was still referred to by its Greek name until at least Georgius Pachymere at the beginning of the 14th century. Following deep historical changes, it took on the name currently used. Taking a step back in history, we return to when the Caesar flowed during the ancient age. It crossed southern Lydia and Ionia between the mountain ranges of Mount Molo, modern Bosdai, and Masugis, Aydin Daglari. The valley and a considerable part of the southern slopes of Mount the Molos and the northern slopes of Masugis were areas that could be used for agriculture and arboriculture. The main civic centers of the region were Ipaipa, Dios Hieron, and three settlements of the Kilbianoi, Nicaia, Coloe, and Palaiopolis. The area originally belonged to the Lydian population group, which subsequently welcomed Greek, Persian, Macedonian, and finally Roman colonists. The Caesar Valley is known for being the true hinterland of Ephesus. The river is a muddy trickle in the dry season, but swells considerably in the rainy season. The sanctuary of Artemis, the Artemisian of Ephesus, has significant properties in the valley. The historical sources allow us in part to reconstruct the events and function that the river had for the ancients. The Greeks already knew it since the mythical time of the Trojan War, which can constitute a starting point for the story of the history of the Caesar itself and an element of comparison with the other types of sources. As regards the geographical attestation, Caesar is mentioned for the first time in the Iliad, in which the river is mentioned in a series of similes, which indicate the advance of Agamemnon's army towards Troy and which precedes the list of the catalogue of ships. Like the dense flocks on winged birds of geese and cranes and long-necked swans, on the Asian prairies around the Caesar currents, they flutter here and there, proud of their wings. Then they come to rest with clamor and the meteor rumbles. So from the ships and the tents, the hosts of men, they spilled onto the plain of Scamander. The earth resounded terribly under their feet and those of the horses. This similitude is inserted in the first section of the second book, which is related to the organization of Agamemnon's army. which landed in Asia Minor and is preceding the catalog section. The advance of the Achaeans resembles the flock of birds that noisily crowd in large numbers on the meadow around the Crystal River. The narrative sequence of these verses metaphorically represents the march of Agamemnon's troops across the plain, which prepares the explanation for the catalog of Achaeans. Hephaestus of Thessalonica, in his commentary on the Iliad, says, that is a prairie in Asia so called for Asios, around the river Caister, along which geese, cranes, and swans, and other such water-loving birds live. The Caister River then flows through the current of the burnt region, about which we have said elsewhere. Caister is named for the fact that it is located near the burnt region, from which, according to the geographer, a wine famous for its quality, Catacecaumenetis, is derived. The Byzantine interpreter, compared to other sources, gives a specific reference regarding to the location and origin of the name Caister, which would be legitimated to derive from the root cau of the verb caio, to burn, and it is located in the area that falls under the influence of the burnt region, perfect past participle. The region called Catacecaumene, the burnt, is the upper valley of the Hermos River in Asia Minor, north of the Ephesus, and it is the area from which extends an area consisting of surface formed by a basaltic lava cones deposited by remote volcanic eruptions. It is therefore an area with lively volcanic activity, which would have the merit of creating a particular environment. Strabo, geographer of the Augustan age, offers us a scientific explanation of the phenomenon. After these places lies the region known as Catacecaumene, completely devoid of trees except for the wine, which produce the Catacecaumenite wine, which in quality is by no means negligible compared to the other famous ones. The surface of the plains is similar to ashes. The rocky and mountainous parts are black as if from a fire. Some assume, therefore, that this happens due to lightning and igneous effusions. However, it is conceivable that such a vast region suddenly caught fire due to such phenomena and not rather due to underground fires. This is what we can glean about the Caister and its nature. By the Byzantine exegete, specifies that various kinds of birds settle around the river Caister and preferred to bathe in its waters, presumably in a season such as spring, as mentioned above. Returning to Iliadic verses, the poet of the catalogue offers a fragment of a naturalistic picture in which the streams of the Caister are associated with the return of the birds and the presence of vegetation. That images mark the rhythm of spring. Sorry. The liveliness and the vividness of the Caister meadows are well represented by the image offered by an exegete to the Descriptio Orbis of Dionysius the Phrygeta. Many, in fact, are the meadows in Asia. There are flowering valleys, most excellently of all those around the Meander Valley, where the river Caister flows, splashing its sparkling waters serenely and gently. The characteristic of locus amenus is therefore confirmed once again by the sources, with natural data that can also be related to the period subsequent to that narrated in the Iliad. The gathering of the Achaean army is compared to the attitude of the world of nature, presenting not in its threatening aspect, As often happens in relation to the similarities in relation to firebirds and pastures, but as harmonious cooperation. Strabo, confirming the Homeric data from centuries ago, reports that the lower areas of the Caesar Plains were marshes frequented by ducks, swans, and cranes, as we see later. The Homeric similitude of a Caesar environment, sweet and favorable to fauna, also return in some verses of Virgil's Georgics, which expands it with the sweet image of the birds bathing in its warm waters. Then the multicolored birds of the sea and those that roam around the meadows of Asia in the gentle lagoons of Caesar bathe their backs with great sprays in competition. Now you see them dipping their heads in the billows, now running on the waves and rejoice all the time for the pleasure of bathing. Therefore, the representation of the Caesar, whose waters flow gently, conforms to the season and the nature of the landscape. Returning to the Homeric context, these verses that mention the river constitute one of the few detailed references in the Iliad to the western coast of the Aegean outside the Troad, and represent a cross-section of the geographical reality of the space and the poetic space in which the epic dimension is intertwined with the historical topography. Everything would suggest that the poet or the bard knew this place as well. The Iliad, says Martin West, shows a knowledge of Asia Minor from the Hellespont to Caister that strongly suggests that its author lived somewhere between those limits. Moreover, the ancients tended to locate, we can say, Homer's homeland precisely in Ionian Asia. If the writing of the poem is to be understood around the 8th century BC, as many scholars suggest, it is likely that the river in question was known at its time, and perhaps even earlier. The areas around the Caister, the current Kyushuk Menderes, is a flat and today marshy area surrounded by low mountains. Subsequent references to the Caister are found in a fragment of Shilax of Karyanda that dating back to the beginning of the 5th century BC, in a section of the histories of Herodotus, historian of the first quarter of the 5th century BC. It is often associated par excellence with river currents. It does not tell us that the Caister was a river that flows in Asia Minor. Shilax of Karyanda, in fact, noting in his Periplus the places he visited in Ionia, mentioned Caister defining it for the first time as Potamos. In Shilax's list, the Caister appears immediately after Colophon and before Ephesus, and this is a topographical fact that indicates the geographical setting of the location of the river. The first properly historical source that mentioned the Caister is in a section of Herodotus' histories, in which the historian narrates the previous events and the war preparations in view of the burning of Sardis during the Ionian Revolt. The Caister Valley constitutes a mostly mountainous path which had strategic importance in the event of an emergency of a surprise attack such as the Athenian one on Sardis. After arriving in Ephesus with this contingent, the Ionians left their ships at Coressus in the territory of Ephesus and marched inland with large troops, taking the Ephesians as leaders of the march. After marching along the river Caister from there, having crossed the Mount Molos, they reached a conquered Sardis without encountering any resistance and occupied it in every area except the Acropolis. In the panorama of sources at our disposal, Strabo is the only witness to delve into the discussion of Caister. The geographer illustrates the topography, and investigates the history of the Caister Valley in two other sections of his work. Thus, there are many cities named Larissa. The third Larissa is a village in the territory of Ephesus, in the plain of Caister, of which it is said that it had previously been a city. The other reference is a particular fact happened to the Larissians at Caister, the Preconians, and for the third party, the Thessalians. In fact, they all occupied the territory shaped by the alluvial deposits of a river, the Caister, the Hermus, and the Peneus, respectively. The first testimony refers to the Iliadic verses of the catalogue of the Trojans, in which the Pelasgians are mentioned and described, who inhabited the site of Larissa. The locality constitutes the pretext to offer an excursus of the history of the Pelasgians and to list the series of centers called Larissa, in order to identify which Larissa was from which the Pelasgians came. In particular, the Larissa that interests us in our discussion is the one near the Caister in the Ephesian territory, which would not have existed at the time of the Trojan War. And indeed, the region would have belonged to Meonians. From this, it can be deduced that Larissa on the Caister would have been a non-Greek settlement. Considering the second text, it is deduced that Strabo had knowledge of the topography of Asia Minor and continental Greece, since he knows the river Hermus and the Peneus, respectively. In addition to Strabo's testimonies, in the panorama of sources at our disposal, local mythology and the accounts that the Greek imaginary elaborated about Caister also play an important role, giving it a semi-divine origin. According to genealogical tradition, Caister was the son of Achilles and the Amazon Penthesilea. The hero would have united with the Amazon after he killed her. And we can read Eustathius and a lexicon etymologicum magnum. But the most recent accounts also says that Thersites was killed by Achilles when he, after killing the Amazon Penthesilea, took pity on her lying on the ground. Indeed, he was astonished at her beauty, and he was the bravest and the most beautiful, took pity on her lying dead on the ground. The other section, Caister, River of Lydia. From the name Caister, Caister is the son of the Amazon Penthesilea, who generated Thersites in Ascalon, and from her had Semiramis. Servius, the commentator of Virgil, says, Marcia, or warlike, or daughter of Mars, the one who was killed by Achilles, of Achilles, and loved when dead. As indeed some say, after she lay with Achilles, she generated from him her son Caister, after whom a river in Lydia is so named. Another section, important source, is represented by Pausania. It seems to me that Pindar did not know everything about the goddess, for he says that the Amazons built this sanctuary when they made an expedition against Athens and Theseus. But the women from the Thermodon made sacrifices to the Ephesian goddess both then, since they knew of the sanctuary from ancient times, and when they fled Heracles, while others in still earlier times, Dionysus, came here as supplicants. Certainly, however, the sanctuary was not built by Amazons, but by the Phoctonus Coresus and Ephesus. Some believe he was a son of the river Caister, and these were the ones who built the sanctuary, and the city derives its name from Ephesus. Moreover, monetary issues dating back mostly to the Roman area and in connection with Ephesus, which are not the main object of this investigation, document these stories and mythical representation. And I'm going to end my paper. The Caister is represented on coins for the first time during the times of Emperor Adrian, of which around 2000 200 examples have been preserved, becoming the official symbol of the city. They depict the river on the obverse coins, like a bearded old man with an amphora and a horn of plenty. And this image is linked to the works undertaken by the emperor to regulate the flow of his streams in Ephesus. In particular, the Ephesian type from the Aryan age could refer to the canalization works of the river following a flood. If Ephesian monetary issues therefore appear for the first time in Aryan age, they developed during the Antonine period, reaching their peak in the first half of the 3rd century AD and becoming rarer under Gallienus and his sons before finally disappearing, perhaps following the incursions of the Goths and in connection with the great earthquake of the 263 AD. So, at the end of this short review of sources, it is clear that the history of Callister is inseparable from that of Ephesus. The river, in fact, flows in the heart of the city's territory, a city which, at the latest after the age of Sylla, became the capital of the province of Asia. The historical sources and literary representations, but also the monetary issues, raised the questions of the relevance of the relationship between the river and the city and constitutes the identifying element for the history of the Callister River and Valley, as they refer from time to time and different periods to historical events of which tradition has somehow preserved the memory. The focal point of intersection of this relationship is the city's port, which over the centuries, as we have seen, has been exposed to the floods, siltations, and modification due to irregularity of Callister's course and stream, things that were a constant concern for the citizens who lived in the area. The continuous interventions promoted and carried out by royal authorities in the Hellenistic age and by the imperial authorities in the Roman age had the merit of temporarily stemming to the disaster caused by the progradation and the flood phenomena, which were repeated almost periodically, starting then from late antiquity, concurrently with increasingly frequent volcanism phenomena in the valley area. The port increasingly silted up in parallel with the slow and unstoppable decline of Ephesus. It is as if the Callister, which has always been a source of lifeblood for Ephesus and an important resource for the development of the valley, was the very cause of the decline of the Ionian city. This could have happened when it was not known more concretely, intervene with defensive works that would stem the irregular flow of the river and in connection with much larger, much important problems that the Romans had to face during the crisis of the 3rd century AD. In any case, the economy of the Callister Valley, like a large part of that of the entire Greek world at the beginning of the first millennium BC, was characterized by the transition from an agricultural pastoral phase to a maritime commercial phase, with the great development of artisanal activities and exchange of products. It is natural that cities like Ephesus, at the entrance to the privileged communication route, like that of Callister, very rich in land compared to other cities, assumed a leading role in the history of Asia Minor in Greek era, until at least the Hellenistic era and the beginning of the Roman era, and then gradually lost it over the centuries. As we have seen, the Callister has become the symbol of the city of Ephesus, around which stories and myths of different origins and provenance have been developed and elaborated, with the aim to enhance the relationships and the link between the city and the river itself. So, to conclude, sum up, the study of Caissar and its topographical and historical reality, as we have seen, poses makes various methodological difficulties, above all because the sources don't fully inform us of the events that occurred and were caused by the irregularity of the river, and the preserved information only allow us to reconstruct partially the eventful history of an area that has always been flourishing and at the center of the Greek micro-Asian civilization. Only few new findings will be able to provide answers to questions that historians have been asking for many centuries. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Di Benedetto, for this structured introduction, which was very enlightening for the diachronic development of the region, combining literature, geography, geology, and archaeology. So many data. Thank you so much. According to the program, we have only some, if there is a need to ask something very, you know, urgent, or discussion will follow after the end of the whole session. And Professor Ricci will coordinate it. So if there are any questions, please ask now, urgent questions, or we proceed to the next presentation, the next paper by Dr. Aitor Bianco Perez. And is Dr. Perez here?
Yes, I am.
Ah, yes, okay. So okay. The title of the paper is Summa Honoraria, Inscriptions and Epigraphic Boundaries in the Mid-Caister Valley. Please, Dr. Perez. You have the...
Thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. I hope you are... I'm trying to share the screen. I don't know if you see it.
Of course.
Oh, no, not this one. That's my email. Okay, let me... Just a second. I'm trying to... Okay, maybe this one. Okay, yeah, that should be it. Can you confirm that you see the presentation?
Everybody can see it.
Yes, perfectly. Yes,
thank
perfect.
You.
Okay, thank you.
Yes,
thank you. So, good morning, good night to everyone, and thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. It's absolutely a pleasure to share some thoughts about a region that sometimes you have to explain a bit why you do some research on this region, but this is a fantastic opportunity. So I'm going to be focusing mostly on the very rich epigraphic evidence. Let's start the presentation. So in the south of Lydia, between the polis of Ephesus and Philadelphia, the valley crossed by the river Caister has provided us with an exceptional dossier of inscriptions, which shed light on the local administration of this territory and the conditions of rural civic life in the 3rd century CE. Despite the relatively rich evidence, this area has never been sufficiently studied, in my opinion, and there's a combination of factors that has led into this circumstance. So, first of all, at least as regards epigraphic studies, this area was included in the corpus of Ephesus, almost like a sort of annex, and consequently, their context and regional particularities were partly neglected. Second, the Caister Valley was eminently a rural area. Its well-irrigated lands along the road from Sardis to Ephesus were devoted to mostly agricultural activities, and therefore there is an absence of the great urban developments that did not attract the attention of so many scholars, despite the recent or praiseful efforts, mainly by Mariana Ritschel, who is here. So I'm very glad to, I'm slightly afraid, but glad that, that she is here, and Hassan Malai. And finally, and this is what I'm going to try to show you today, it is quite a complex region. I'm going to be focusing on exactly the middle of the Kaister Valley and the areas that Paolo has shown to us. So thank you very much for that introduction. That will save me some explanations. So that middle plain of the Kaister Valley is today dominated by the town of Tire, a recent in our terms, hub of agricultural and trading goods that did not exist in the Roman imperial age. In this period, the fields surrounding this town seem to have marked the eastern frontier of the territory of Ephesus. No, as you can see on the map, no boundary inscriptions of the land of Artemis have been discovered beyond the imaginary line linking the settlement and the undoubtedly Ephesian Larissa, as Paolo has shown with those very nice texts. However, the cadastre lists drafted at the end of the 3rd century CE show that the ancient settlement around Kireli, so that's the area that you find with the orange circle, already belonged to another polis, in this case, Ipaipa. This lack of natural geographical boundaries in the plain, together with the later development of Tire, has caused a high volume of traveling stones, which were removed from their original location and are inserted in many buildings of the modern town, as you can see on the images. All these factors make it particularly difficult to examine the epigraphic evidence from this frontier area. So, within this very complex scenario, there is a number of inscriptions that record the payment of sums of money in connections with local offices. These testimonies have traditionally been used to illustrate the existence of the so-called summa honoraria in the eastern part of the Roman Empire. Which I mean with summa honoraria is that the access to certain offices have to be made through the payment of certain fees, as we have very extensive evidence from the western part of the Roman Empire. This is something that we don't know with, it's not very clear how it worked in Greek politics and in the Greek cities, but people have used the following inscriptions, the one that I'm going to be showing you today to illustrate this. So beyond that controversy that it's that has generated a lot of debate, as you can imagine, what I'm going to be focusing today is that these inscriptions, the inscriptions of the so-called summa honoraria, can actually help us to establish better epigraphic boundaries in the mid-Kaister Valley. The most famous inscription of the group, the one that you have on the screen, was discovered in a reused context of Tire and records the payment of 250 denarii by a man called Aurelius Hermolaus for a local office, Hyperarches Logisteias, which served to a particular payment, Eisten ton teironon sinteleion, following a decision of the villagers, kathos edoxe tois kometais. This rare term tiron refers to the contribution that communities could present in exchange for the recruitment of soldiers by the Roman army. A closer examination of the text also revealed that this payment was made when the junior Lucius Septimius Aurelius Achillides was prytanis. The use of this formula, referring to specific magistracy, necessarily placed the inscription within an Ephesian sphere where the prytaneia was the eponymous office. Another inscription the one that you have on the left-hand side of the screen, 3247i Ephesus, was also found in the walls of the former church of the Holy Taxiarchy in Tyre, and records another payment that the Ephesian Aurelius Lariseos made for the Logisteia after the head, the proestos of the Catholicia, the Thierian Marcus Aurelius Artemidorus, had encouraged him. Again, Ephesian elements are evident throughout this text. The prytanis dating formula, the month Neocesareon, and the career of Artemidorus himself, who was a Philosebastos bullark and hypnodos of Artemis. Even though the purpose of this contribution is lost, we note that the procedure was conducted, as the Greek text says, dia sin logu. Louis Robert interpreted this expression as par devant l'assemblée, the great Anatolian scholar. In this case, he was probably wrong. This is quite a lot to say in this case, because there is another stone, the one that you have on the right-hand side, I Ephesus 3249, which was found on the walls of the Ulu Jami, and it points towards a more specific use of local terminology. On this occasion, it is recorded that those who were logistai of the katoikia of the apateirenoi provided 250 denarii in one contribution, so epimia philotemia, when, and I quote, they were given the logos. Once more, the contribution was encouraged by another prominent member called Lucius Hierax, and its purpose was to repair the great bath, the Megalu Balaniu. All this information combined suggests that the sin logos does not refer to any assembly, but rather to some sort of joint account or logos to which the logistai of the different settlements of the Katoikia had to contribute. So the question here, and why I think it's also interesting, not only as regards local civic procedures, is that while we have similarities in the procedures launched by both Marcus Aurelius Artemidorus and Titus Flavius Lucius Hierax, I will try to show that there are also some differences, some discrepancies with regard to the territories in which such procedures took place. So, on the one hand, the activities of Artemidorus occur, as I said before, in a clear Ephesian context. The particular formula dating Lucius Hieras' encouragement, the one that you have with the etus in the Greek inscription, however, point toward a more a different territory, in this case, the territory of Epipa. And why do we know that this might be Epipan territory? So the inscription specifies that the refurbishment of the great baths was dedicated to the Empress Caracalla Angita in the year 259. So if we convert that into real years, that gives us 211 and 12 according to the Caesarian era. So as will be evident later, this dating method was frequently used in the territory of Epipa and the northern Kaister Valley, where there is no trace of Ephesian prytanis and that eponymous office. Lucius Hierax, moreover, as you can see on the right-hand side, has also appeared as magistrate on the coins of Epipa under Lucius Severus, Julia Domna, and Caracalla, so we can be even more certain about this chronology. And this was also a very, very recent find in a numismatic bit of this year, where you can see Lucius Septimius Severus on the left, and also Hierax, in this case, with what appears to be Caracalla Geta holding some sort of homonoia, or even some people have suggested the Artemis of Epipa itself. So again, we have very clear chronology of both of these men in this territory acting at the same time. So this important detail has been ignored or at least slightly neglected by previous scholars studying the so-called Summa Honoraria inscriptions and should challenge the attribution of both I Ephesus 3246 and 3247 to the Katoikia of Apadai Tenoi, as you can see here on the Ephesian corpus. So a closer re-examination of the evidence reveals instead that similar offices, such as the Logisteia, and procedures, such as the Synlogos, were most likely served between two poleis, Ephesus and Ipaipa, which organized their rural communities in neighboring territories through a similar Katoikia Komai model, which was already present in Hellenistic period, as some recent inscriptions published by Mariana Rachel have confirmed. So now we reach the kind of like the easier part of the presentation, because most of these inscriptions, the Summa Honoraria inscriptions, were found in the specific context, and that context is that of the Didei Phita and around the village of Kyrylli today. So the first inscription here, or like from this group, is again dated to the Caesarian era, in this case in 213, with the reference to the year and also to Caracalla sole reign. In that year, Marcus Aurelius Menander, a man from Ipaipa, gave 250 denarii for his comarchia after he had previously given 50 denarii for the reconstruction of the old baths. The next testimony of the group dates to 226 and records that Aurelius Metrodorus gave 500 denarii for the comarchia. Additionally, it is stated that Aurelius Menophantes, Aurelius Afianus, and those with them were comarchs at the same time. From that remark, it should be inferred that the Katoikia of Ipaipa, similarly to those belonging to Ephesus, were composed of several comae, each of which had its own comarch. Likewise, both dated testimonies mention the existence of a voted resolution by the Katoikia, so again, kathos sephisato, and references to more sephismata also occur in both the undated payment of 1,000 denarii made by Anipaipan Agoranomos, Aurelius Croesus, and another contribution of 750 denarii that was used for the restoration of the new baths. So a contextualized analysis of this evidence confirms, in my opinion, the undeniable connection between the recorded payments and the holding of a specific local magistracies. However, the continuous references to a specific resolutions adopted by different Katoikia or Komai challenges, in my view, the assumption that such a procedure was as simple and regular as a standardized Summa Honoraria. Firstly, the sums of money given by the different logistai vary at a rate that doesn't even match inflation in the 3rd century AD. Secondly, the contributions are almost always linked with exceptional expenses, be it the Tyron, as we saw in the first inscription, or the repair of bathing facilities. Thirdly, why would local notables such as Marcus Aurelius Artemidorus or Lucius Hierax need to promote and encourage institutionalized payments for offices all the time? These observations should prevent the use of such documents as clear attestations of Summa Honoraria in the eastern part of the Roman Empire. On the contrary, the testimonies from the Mid-Kaister Valley serve to highlight the presence of mechanisms of cooperation that rural communities could trigger in the 3rd century CE when they agree to undertake bigger enterprises. Indeed, this reality was still valid in 272-273, according to the latest testimony available from Quirelli. On this occasion, Aurelius Marcus gave 1,000 denarii for the homarchia after having made a previous contribution that was then encouraged as customary, kathos ethos, the one that you have here, Ephesus 38:56. So, kind of coming to an end, this procedure had clearly consolidated in the Mid-Kaiser Valley during the 3rd century CE. However, the tradition does not seem to be caused by any financial crisis of the Severan and post-Severan period, according to the last inscription of my dossier, which was discovered again in this very complex context of Tyre and in a reused environment. So this fragment informs of 8 columns, again, it's very fragmentary, the activities of Alogistes from Epipa in the year 111-102 CE, and the existence of a local resolution. The name of the Katoikia is not included, but thanks to that reference of Epipenos, we know that almost certainly it belonged to the territory of Epipa. So more surprising is the year in which the inscription was apparently set up. According to the earlier editors, the reading of the fragment was clear, so I have to trust them. But again, like this date does not match the rest of 3rd century AD inscription. In this, we are talking about 111. So that brings us to Trajan's reign and consequently shows that the procedure of giving money in connection with local offices had precedence and was not a complete innovation. So with this revision, what I intended to do is to put these exceptional inscriptions in a more defined context that can improve our understanding of the procedures and circumstances included in them. My hope is now is that we can continue to explore this fascinating area and carry on the work of more recent scholars, such as mentioned before, Mariana, Rachel, and Hassan Malai, so that we can reveal more and more details of an area that has the potential to contribute to debates about ancient politics and rural life well beyond the boundaries and particularities of Roman Anatolia. So that's it from my side. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Perez, for this very innovative view of the testimonies you have studied and the really rich information you have. I would never thought that we would take so much information about the structure of the places of these small places, but who have developed a lot of relations between them, and it's very really hopeful that we will have more in the future. So thank you so much. And now we proceed to our next paper by Alios Khan. Dr. Alios Khan is going to speak from Paul on the subject from Polis to Castron, an overview of the changing physiognomy of the urban settlements in the Eastern Kaiser Valley, Kiraz Beydag. Please, Dr. Özkan.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, we do.
Yes, of course.
Yes.
Ekran paylaşıyorum.
We cannot hear.
Sorry.
If you have started, and we'll have You have, yeah, please, yes. Okay, now it's okay. Thank you.
Hocam oldu mu acaba şu anda?
Hayır, Ali.
Olmadı mı?
Sorun değil.
Hocam bir saniye.
Bekleriz, sıkıntı yok.
Ekranı görüyor musunuz hocam?
Yeah, we do see your screen, but we cannot see your PowerPoint yet. Don't worry, if you can send it to me, I can also show it. Bana gönderirsen ben de açabilirim, hiç sıkıntı yok.
Hocam bir saniye.
Hiç sıkıntı yok. We have a little bit problem with also translation, so I will be going to be the one who is going to be translate everything.
Sesim açık ama şey yapamadım. Paylaşamadım. Arkada şey gözükmesi lazım. Slide'ın olduğu yeri. Onu açmana gerek yok mu? Bunun arkasında kaldı. Hayır yani. Şu, bunun gitmesi lazım.
Ney?
Yani şunu göremiyorum.
We can see the background of your computer.
Yes,
şu gitmiyor.
What's going on?
No, not the thing.
But it's not so grave. You can you
Bir
can
şey
proceed if you want. If it's not possible.
Ali, istersen bana da gönderebilirsin. You can also send the PowerPoint to me so that I will just show it if you want to. Bana da gönderebilirsin, ben de gösterebilirim.
And you see,
Now we can see. Şu an görüyoruz.
Yes, and you
şükür.
Can. I think you can press the sign in the bottom, which is like a little cup, so the picture
Buraya
will
bas diyor. Şu ortaya bas istersen Ali. Bak, aferin.
Oldu şimdi.
Süper, süper.
Sorry, sorry. Hello everyone.
No problem.
Before proceeding with the presentation, I will wanna thanks to especially to Professor Ergun Laflı for their contribution to the conference. My presentation is based on the doctoral thesis I completed this year. For the thesis research, conducted surveys in the Küçük Menderes Valley from 2019 to 2022. Through these surveys, I had the opportunity to observe the urbanization process in the region. Additionally, I visit numerous settlements with archaeological from local museum. The resource also incorporates the results obtained by local museum through limited excavations. I want to thanks to Turkish Historical Society in Turkish Türk Tarihi Kurumu for the doctoral scholarship they provide over the course of 4 years. This scholarship has afforded me the financial means to reach numerous villages and towns in the region. The scholarship from the Turkish Historical Society is granted from funds transferred from the personal legacy of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, the founder of the Republic of Turkey and also the founder of the Turkish Historical Society in accordance with his will. I respectfully commemorate Atatürk for his effort is in establishing in science of archaeology as a serious discipline in our country. So the name Küçük Menderes Valley is derived from the river Küçük Menderes, which originate in the distinction of kiraz in Izmir and flows in the Aegean Sea at Pamucak Beach in the Selçuk distinction of Izmir province. The Küçük Menderes River and it is valley constitute an ecology significant area with unique fauna and flora where intensive agriculture activities take place. The region include the distinction of Selçuk, Tire, Torbalı, Bayındır, Ödemiş, Kiraz, and Beyday, all belonging to Izmir province. The abundance of water sources and fertile individual plains in region has made it private settlement are seen in ancient times. Archaeological research indicate that the earliest settlement in region date back to the late Neolithic period, for example, Dedecik and Çukurcuhöyük. The region has become a significant agricultural production center, playing a crucial role in the meeting Izmir's food demands. The area cultivate various production, primarily olive as well as figs, walnut, chestnut, and more. Identically, the region is prominent in cattle farming. We can acknowledge that during the insight period, when factors like disruption in the current ecosystem and global warming were not present, the valley was much more fertile than it is today. In insight period, Küçük Menderes Valley was deleted in the separate plains. To the west of the valley lies the Kaistros Plain and to the east lies the Kilbos Plain. The most significant city in the region is undoubtedly Ephesus. Apart from Ephesus, Hypaipa, Metropolis, Diosioron and Neikai are central settlement city. In the addition, settlements like Koloya and Palaiopolis are mentioned city inscription date back to 3rd century. The focus on Kilbos situated the eastern part of the Küçük Menderes Valley and the settlement within Kilbos. Roman period settlement in the Kilbos Plain, namely Neikai, Palaiopolis, and Koloya, are introduced based on existing archaeological data. Subsequently, the evolving physiognomies of these settlements in the late Antique and Byzantine period, influenced by various catalysts, are discussed. The characteristic new settlement model, enclosed by walls and described in the literature as the transition from Polis to Kastron, is traced in Kilbos. The Byzantine Empire, strained by Sasanian and Arab invention, constituted construction new defense structures on strategic position and hills. These circumstances led to a defensive structuring of the empire, now as the Tema administrative system. It is understood that during this process, the Küçük Menderes Valley in particular was equipped with new defensive structure as part of the Tema military administrative system. Additionally, cities were surrounded by robust fortification. Particularly during the Lascaris period, a significant construction program was implemented in the region. The city of Palaiopolis in the Beyda distinction of Izmir extensively discussed in the city process such an urban structure. Although lacking written evidence, the city was structured in Palaiopolis Beyres striking resembly to Lascaris architecture. Therefore, the late development of the city have been examined considering the political, social, and economic aspects of the Lascaris period. With the enclosed area Palaiopolis, a basilica plain church has been identified. Palaiopolis and other Castron tip settlements in the region are situated by comparing them with Western Anatolia, Greece, and the Aegean Island. The Lascaris, who had summer palace in New Phaion, extended their political influence to Western Anatolia. The proximity of imperial power to the region paved the way for the empire to gain prestige through construction program. This process can be considered the last progress played in the Byzantine era for Kilbos and the Küçük Menderes Valley. The city in the region stand out with their influence. Rural settlement process reached agricultural lands during the Roman period and late antique period. Numerous villages have been identified in the territories associated with these cities. Identically, in my research, I identified numerous Villa Rustica, empowered by the advantages of agricultural production. Villa owners adorned their residence with decoration that suited their budgets. Many floor mosaics serve as indicators of these villas. A Villa Rustica identified in hinterland of Yupaipa is quite impressive with its addition such as bathhouse. Numerous areas storing amphora have been identified in this area, indicating wine production. Inside, writers mentioned the region wine production suggests that he quality wines were produced especially on the slope of Mount Molos and Mesogis. In the sea slides, you see the finding related to be mentioned Villa Rustica. The ceramic finding date back to the late Hellenistic to early Empire period, reigning from the 45th century. I propose that in later phase of the Villa Rustica, perhaps the last owner was Christian. The ampulla found here is the best evidence. These finds from the bathhouse balneum area in the Villa Rustica, a coin from the Gratianus area, indicates used in the 4th century, the region of empires. The procession of rich loot rural lands by cities has brought about multifaceted consequence. Aristocrats who owned property in the countryside accumulated capital through agriculture production, enabling them to provide financial support for construction projects in the cities. The characterization of city by rich public structures further emphasizes this phenomenon. During the Roman imperial period, under the rule of Trajanus, Aristion, an elite from Ephesus, had a massive aqueduct built, surged from the Küçük Menderes Valley. The fact that such a large bridges project was commissioned by an elite is important in understand the strength of the elite in the region. The reality experienced in the countryside during the 4th and 6th centuries phenomenon observed through the Eastern Mediterranean is also evident in the Küçük Menderes Valley. The floor mosaic identified in the village of Yolüstü in Ödemiş. The absence of any religion built buildings in this location, along with contemporary explains, led me to consider it is a floor mosaic of a Villa Rustica. Can you see the details of the mosaic in photographs and drawing? Up until this period, cities had a prominent appearance with public structure taking center stage. However, changing tradition brought about a sharp transformation in the urban fabric. First, Arab and the Sasani invention shattered the dream of empire becoming a universal power. Arabs conducted seasonal raids for two centuries. Their strategic position, especially in crucial points like Tarsus, paved the way for the activities of the Arab navy in the again in the subsequent period. Numerous coastal cities and inland areas were straining under sudden Arab attack. The empire managed to overcome this tension through the Tema military system. Cities were in their need of new defensive structures, not only in cities but also in small settlements. We characteristic these positions in the transition from polis to castrum. Ernest Christen, 48-page article, The Byzantine State. It is pioneering work in terms of scholarly studies on this subject. In his work, he chronology examined in Byzantine cities as early, middle, and late. He discusses Byzantine cities divided in three periods using administrative, social, settlement, typology, architecture, architectural, and topographical concepts. Kirsten becomes first person to formulate the formation of the Byzantine cities in the Middle Age as a transition from polis to castrum. And anonymous Byzantine treatise on strategy date to the 6th century rules to use that cities must now have new proprietaries. When they started building large cities, the care taken to make the cities look beautiful was no less important than security. They built many cities on flat ground and built them with gardens and green. But my point of view is that is unclear what will happen this city. In my opinion, safety is probably more important than a beautiful appearance. I would prefer cities to be policed and fortified in such a way as to ward off the attacks of any disease. This really makes this really makes you think about the transformation of polis, which attract attention with its rich public building, monumental architecture, sculpture, and decoration. Undoubtedly, the classic polis turned into a combination of many reasons. One of the reasons is the change in mentality of the elites who finance public construction programs. No one donates money for a store, bathhouse, or theater anymore. Good citizens have become good Christians. A significant portion of donation goes to the church. The most important building in wealth settlement are new churches. These walls also protect the episcopal residence and water source. The city I examined, the Beyda district of Izmir province, Palaya Polis, is one of the fortified settlements with walls resembling a castrum. The history of settlement extends back to less the Iron Age. Roman and Byzantine settlements are present on a mound in the area. Inside the walls, here the Grand Basilica Plain Church. There is like a ladder face of the church, probably construction in the late antique period. A significant portion of the fingings belong to this later phase. The root ships and cup sheep lab example found during excavation are similar to these dating between 11th-13th century. Similar cup fragment massive, longed and flat-based exemplary dating the late Byzantine period have been discovered in Palaiopolis and Anaya. Glass artifacts consistent with coins and ceramic complex exemplary systems have been identified. The second phase church was likely construction in the 6th century and should have stood until the least 13th century. Another Castron settlement in the region is Kiraz Hisarköy. It is quite similar to Beyda. It probably dates back to Lascaris period. Here to the defensive structure is located on a mound dating back to early period, just like Kuşadası Anaya. The equipment of settlements with defensive structure undoubtedly began much early. For example, Valens was killed on the battlefield during the war within Goths. This was a real trauma. From now on, the empire took the city walls serious into the agenda. He had it built. The Theodosians, who become to power after Valens, that his job successfully in the capital. Sasanian and Arabs right for seed settlement to build defensive structure in almost the entry empire. Küçük Menderes Valley settlement have many exemplary in this regard. One of the most impressive castle in the region is Küçük Keçi Kalesi, which protects Ephesus. These use will be further clarified in future projects that will examine the Byzantine settlement history of the region. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you so much for this excellent presentation, the rich material, and we look forward for the publication of this material. It's really impressive. And we proceed to the next paper now, which is a joint paper entitled A Group of Red on White Lamps from the Museum of Tire by Dr. Enda Kugor Alper, Dr. Koray Alper, Mr. Semus Tekin, and Faruk Tekin. Please, you have the floor.
Merhaba.
Would you, Dr. Özkan, okay, thank you.
Yes, I'll be just sort of translating her into English. I will try.
Evet, nereden?
Eda'cığım sen...
Bilemiyorum ama bir saniye, bir dakika hemen.
Ha, Eda ben mi yapayım yine canım?
Yok, bir dakika şimdi. PowerPoint'i açtım. Aşağıda bilemiyorum da şeyi.
İstersen ben de açayım, sorun değil. There you go, perfect.
Şu anda evet.
Yürüyoruz, çok güzel yürüyoruz. Tamam. Yes, we can see.
Tam böyle kalsın o zaman. Öncelikle çevir için Profesör Doktor Ergün Laflı'ya teşekkür ediyorum.
She's taking me.
şöyle hemen. Evet. Tire kuzeyinde Bayındır, doğusunda Ödemiş, güneyinde Aydın, Aydın ili, batısında Torbalı ili, Selçuklu ilçeleri bulunan büyük bir ilçe.
Tire is a township in Turkey, which is bordered by Torbalı, Selçuk, Aydın, and Ödemiş in the southeastern part of province of İzmir, Turkish province of İzmir.
İzmir'e yaklaşık 100 kilometre uzaklıkta.
It is almost 100 kilometers far from İzmir.
Küçük Menderes Nehri'nin kenarında ve verimli topraklara sahip.
It is just located right on the plain of Castres Valley and has fertile soil for agriculture.
Bu nedenle de her dönemde yerleşim görmüş bir yer.
Because of this reason, Tire was populated by several different civilizations in different periods of time.
Bu çalışmada 26 tane red and white kandil incelenmiştir Tire Müzesi'nde bulunan.
In the study, I have examined 26 pieces of red and white lamps which are being stored in the Museum of Tire, in the local Museum of Tire.
İlk kandil yarı volütlü olarak ayrılan kandiller burun tiplerine göre ayrılırlar ve gördüğünüz kandil yarı volütlüdür.
I have classified those lamps according typologically according to their nozzles, and the first sample is from Tire, and it has been classified according to its nozzle form.
Bu formda gövde ile burun arasındaki volütler tek taraflıdır.
The volutes between the nozzle and the body of these lamps are one-formed, one-shaped.
Ayrıca diskus çizgisinden başlar ve burunun dışına taşmadan biter.
This shape has been just bordered by two frame bordered in the volutes with two stripes.
Bir diğer kandil çift burunludur.
Second example has two nozzles.
Volütlü bir kandildir.
It has also volutes.
Tire'ye bağlı Darnara köyünden ele geçmiştir.
It has been found in a small locality in Tire, in Barnalı. Barnalı.
Darnara.
Darnalı. Sorry.
Kil bu kandilde kil açık kırmızı. Yüzeyde
The clay of the lamp is light red.
Çok aşındığı için yüzeyde çok az olarak kırmızı renkte boya izlerini görüyoruz.
Because of its sort of slipped, we can still discern some red slip right on the on these lamps.
Omuz kenarı bezemesiz, diskus içinde ise rozet motifi vardır.
The shoulder is undecorated and the discus has a rosette as a decoration, as an ornamental pattern.
Bir diğer burun tipi kalp burunlulardır.
We have also a second typology, which is heart-shaped nozzle form. Yes.
Bu kandil Ankara'da bulunmuş ancak Tire Müzesi'ne gelmiştir.
This lamp has been transported from Ankara Museum to Tire.
Yine açık kırmızı bir kile sahiptir. Kırmızı boyalıdır.
It is also plain shaped and without any decoration and has also a light red color in its clay.
Diğer bir kalp burunlu kandil Turgutlu köyünden ele geçiyor.
And a second example of a heart-shaped nozzled lamp has been found in the village of Turgutlu in Tire.
Kil çoğu kandilde olduğu gibi açık kırmızı, yüzeyde kırmızı renkte astarlıdır.
Its clay is a light red with a slip, which is also in light red color.
Omuzun tamamını kaplayan çelek benzeri bitkisel bir motif vardır.
On the shoulder we can see a wreath which is covered on the whole shoulder in a horizontal frame.
Burun üzerindeki kalp şeklinin tam ortasında baskı biçimli nokta yer alır.
On the heart-shaped nozzle we can clearly see a stamped dot right in front of the nozzle's part.
Bazı kalp burunlu kandillerde bu tarzda nokta bezemeyi görebiliyoruz.
We can see that type of dot shaped stamps on heart shaped nozzles.
Gövde yapısı diğer kandillere göre farklıdır bu kandilin.
The typology of the body form of the lamp is differing from the other samples at the museum.
Evet, yine Açık kırmızımsı kahverengi bir kile sahip.
It has a light red color in its clay.
Diğer kandillere göre astarı daha iyi korunmuş ve daha canlı bir renge sahipti.
This slip has been sort of preserved compared to the other samples that she presented, and it has also a little bit more darker red slip.
Akarca köyünden ele geçmiş olan yine red and white tipinde bir kandil.
There is another sample which has been found in the village of Akarca, which is also red and white.
Kırmızı renkli astarı iyi korunmamış.
The slip has not been preserved well.
Ancak diskus ve omuz bezemesi belirgin.
But the ornamentation of discus is very discernible.
Diskus içinde elinde kornikopya bir Nike figürü, diğer elinde de başka bir obje tutuyor.
In the discus, you can clearly see there is one a figure, which is a taika, with a cornucopia, and she has another object in the other part.
Omuz üzerinde yumurta dizisi bezeme yer alır.
On the shoulder we have a dot row, dotted row. Merhaba, buyurunuz.
Evet, bir diğer kandil.
This is another lamp. This is another lamp.
Yes.
Diskus
içinde Eros figürü var. Elinde yılan tutar.
Tamam, teşekkür ederim. Tamam. We have also we have also
Eros elinde an yılan Eros, tutuyor.
With an holding an object in his hand.
Snake.
He has a snake, a serpent in his hand.
Kil koyu kahverengi, yine kil açık kahverengi renkte, yüzey ise dalgalı renkte astarlı.
The slip is again dark brown, but we have a slip in white. The clay is dark brown, but the slip is in white color.
Omuz üzerinde yine yumurta dizisi görülüyor.
On the shoulder, we can clearly see a row of egg and shell.
Özbey köyünden ele geçmiş kalp burunlu bir kandil.
A further sample which has been found in Özbey, in the village of Özbey.
Evet. Yüzeyi oldukça aşındığı için diskus içindeki figür ve omuz üzerindeki bezeme çok net anlaşılamıyor.
As the surface has been sort of worn, we cannot really discern, we cannot really identify the piece, the motif in the discus, which is Medusa. Medusa çok güzel. Yes.
Ayakta duran bir figür var. Discus.
Yes, maybe a standing figure right in the discus.
Yine omuz üzerinde yumurta dizisi.
And again, egg and shell, egg and dot row right on the shoulder.
Bir başka kandil yine red and white ve kalp burunlu.
We have another red and white sample with a simplified and degenerated decoration.
Astarı oldukça iyi korunmuş.
The slip has been preserved very well, as you see.
Kalp burunlu yine astarı iyi korunan bir kandil.
Another sample with a well-preserved slip.
Canlı kırmızı tonlarında boyaya sahip.
Has a very fresh tone of a red color on the slip.
Diskus içinde başı sağa dönük olarak verilmiş köpek betimlemesi vardır.
And in the discus we have a duck representation whose head is turned to the right.
Kalp burunlu bir başka kandil.
Another heart-shaped nozzled lamp.
Tire civarından bulunmuş.
Found in the environment of Tire, in the surroundings of Tire.
Yüzey oldukça aşınmış. Bu nedenle astarın boyu, astar rengini net olarak göremiyoruz.
One cannot clearly identify the color of the slit because of the worn structure of the surface.
Diskus içinde zeytin dalı üzerinde duran bir güvercin vardı.
And in the discus we have a doll figure which is standing right on a olive palm right in the discus, in the middle of the discus.
Kalp burunlu kandiller gibi bu dönemde U burunlu olarak ayrılan kandiller de vardır.
Another category of this group is beside heart-shaped nozzle is also ne burunluydu? Şey.
U-shaped
or U-formed nozzle.
O Tire Müzesi'nde 13 adet U burunlu kandil ele vardır.
13 samples of U-shaped nozzled lamps are existing, are being created in the Museum of Tire.
Bu kandilde omuz ve diskus bezemesiz olarak görülür.
This sample has no decoration neither on the shoulder nor in the discus.
Yine bezemesiz olan bir başka red on white kandil.
Another red on white sample without any decoration.
Uygur köyünden ele geçmiştir.
Found in the village of Uygur.
Yine 73-18 envanter numaralı Tire civarından bulunan bir kandil. Yüzeyi oldukça aşınmıştır ve kalkerlidir. Bu nedenle astarı net biçimde görülemiyor.
There is another sample in the same museum with the inventory number 7318. The slip has been worn away so that one cannot really discern about the decoration.
Bir başka kandil, bezemesiz olan bir başka kandil. Kil kırmızı, yine yüzeyi çok aşınmış ama kırmızı astarı görülebiliyor.
This is another the undecorated lamp sample with the red slip, which is easily discernible.
Evet, 99-1 envanter numaralı yine Tire civarından bulunmuş U burunlu kandil.
Another U-shaped nozzled lamp from the environment, from the surroundings of Tire.
Yine kırmızı renkte astarı görülebiliyor.
With the red slip. With red slip.
ve bezemesiz olan son kandil U formlu.
That's the last sample of undecorated U-shaped lamp.
Evet. Bu kandili red on white ve U formlu.
U-shaped lamp in red on white.
Fakat Bailey tarafından Efesos kandillerini incelediği yayınında Efesos B3 olarak ayrılan burun yapısına sahip sınıf bu şekilde sınıflandırılmış.
Bailey has already been classified that type of forms according to the flamps found in Ephesus and he, according to his category this should be B3.
bu kandilde diskus çevresi kapanmıyor. Burun çizgisine birleşiyor bir kanal yaparak.
The discus has not been closed in this type of lamp, but then makes a channel into the nozzle.
Bu kandilin sadece bir yerde benzeri var, o da Metropolis.
There is only one sample which is sort of similar to this lamp, and this has been found in Metropolis.
Selene figüründen, diskus içinde bir Selene betimlemesi var.
In the discus we have a representation of Selene. It's figuring Selene in the discus.
Yine Bayındır, Tire'ye yakın Bayındır'dan bulunmuş ve Tire Müzesi'ne gelmiş bir kandil.
A lamp which has been found in Bayındır?
Bayındır. Eserin kili açık renkli, açık kırmızımsı kahverengi. Yine kırmızı tonlarında astara sahip.
has a red slip, but the clay is in brownish tones.
Diskus içinde miğferli, zırhlı ve kalkanlı iki gladyatör mücadelesi görülüyor.
In the discus, we have two gladiators. They are fighting to each other.
Burun çizgisinin iki yanında baskı biçimde yapılmış nokta bezeme var.
In the inner part of the nozzle, we have two samples of stamped dots, which are made as perhaps as decoration.
Bir başka U biçimli kandil yine tire çevresinden bulunmuş.
Another U-shaped nozzled lamp from the surrounding of tire.
Diskus içinde at bezemesi var.
In the discus we have the we have a figure of a horse.
Yele ve kuyruğu oldukça detaylı biçimde verilmiş.
A detail shaped horse in terms of its his Rick Rosen's and his head.
Hisarlık köyünden ele geçmiş bir red and white kandil.
Another red and white lamp from Hisarlık, found in Hisarlık, in the village of Hisarlık.
Yüzeyi deforme olmasına karşın oldukça iyi korunmuş.
The surface has been deformed but preserved very well.
Kil açık kırmızı ve kırmızı renkte astarlı.
The clay is light red and the slip is also the same color.
Diskus içinde leylek vardır.
And we have a bird right in the middle part of the discus, right in the center of the discus.
Yine Efesos B3 tipine ait, burun tipine ait bir kandil.
Again, Ephesian type of lamp.
Bu kandil de tire çevresinden bulunmuş. Diskus içinde amfora vardır.
It has been found in the surrounding of Tire, and this time we have the figure, we have a decoration as an amphora right in the middle of this discus.
Amphora'nın omuz kısmına bir çelenk bağlanmıştır.
On the shoulder part of the amphora, we can clearly see a wreath, which has been corded to the amphora.
Kulbun iki tarafında ve burun çizgisi üzerinde de yine baskı biçimli nokta görülür.
In both sides of the handle, as well as on the nozzle, we can clearly see stamped dot decorations.
Yine diskus içinde amfora betimi olan başka bir kandil.
A second sample with the same decoration as amphora in the discus.
Ancak bu kandilde diskus çizgisi kapalıdır. Diskus etrafı kapalıdır.
But this time the decoration has been framed by a stripe which has covered discus and closed the discus shape.
Yüzeyi daha kötü korunmuştur.
The surface of the lamp has not been preserved very well.
Diskus içinde kornikopya olan bir kandil.
Another lamp with cornucopia within its discus.
Omuz üzeri bezemesizdir. Astarı daha iyi korunmuştur.
The shoulder has not been decorated. And it's just like sort of left plain.
Ve burun yapısı farklı olan bir kandil, yüzük burunludur.
Another lamp which has a form of a ring.
Omuz üzerinde üç sıra halinde yapılmış kabartma noktalar vardır.
On the shoulder we have three rows of relieved dots as decoration.
Hisarlık köyünden ele geçmiş.
Has been found in the village of Hisarlık.
Ve son kandil burun tipi burun kenarı kırık olduğu için hangi tipe ait olduğunu bilemiyoruz.
And the last lamp is the one that we cannot really identify typologically because the nozzle has been sort of damaged so that we cannot assign it to any classification, any known classification.
Uzgur Köyü'nden ki bir mezar odasından bulunmuş.
It has been found in a burial chamber in the village of Uzgur or Uygur.
Uzgur.
Uzgur.
Yine iyi korunmuştur astarı, net biçimde görülür.
The slip has been preserved very well. And we can clearly see the slip.
Diskus içinde iki atın çektiği bir at arabası vardır.
In the discus we can clearly see a biga.
Ve üzerinde bir asker figürünün olduğu görülür.
One can identify a soldier as a figure.
Evet, toplamda 26 adet kandil incelendi. Ekleyeyim mi?
We have examined in total 26 lamps in total.
Evet, burun tipi olarak yarım volütlü, volütlü, volütlü çift burunlu, kalp burunlu, U burunlu ve yüzük burunlu kandiller vardır.
The typologies are differentiating according to the nozzles, heart-shaped, U-shaped, two nozzled ones, as well as sondaki neydi? En sondaki neydi?
Ring-shaped.
Ring-shaped ones.
Red and white kandiller genel olarak 1. yüzyılın ortalarından 3. yüzyıla kadar tarihlendirilirler.
These lamps have been dated from the mid first century to the early 3rd century AD.
Ayrıca bu kandillerin üretim yeri olarak Efesos ya da çevresi önerilir.
The production for the location of their production has been suggested as has been proposed as Ephesus or its surrounding, its close surrounding.
Aslında bu nedenle Tire ve çevresine daha çok sayıda görmeyi beklerdik. Ancak çok daha az sayıda müzede korunmakta olan Red and White Kandil var.
As we expected to see them in much more numbers, numerous numbers in Tire, but we do see in few numbers than previously estimated.
Belki yapılacak olan yeni çalışmalarda bu sayı artabilir.
Perhaps in the future there will be some more examples. And she's thanking you for listening.
Teşekkür ederim Ergün hocam.
We thank you so much, Dr. Kungor and Professor Lafley for the translation. And we proceed to our next presentation, who is going to be presented by Professor Lafley, Dr. Sami Patachi, Dr. Gisterlen Kanhasin, Dr. Maurizio Bora, and Professor Hugo Toen, and Mr. Hussein Avni Baloglu. The title of the paper is Recent Archaeological Discoveries in the Upper Kaistor Valley. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Maria. That's very, very kind of you. I just want to ask, can you guys now see the first page of the PowerPoint? Or
yes, but yeah? Could you just?
Yeah, I'll try that one. Is it better right now? Maybe.
Yes, it's clear. It's better, but okay. Now it's good. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. All right. So I'll be keeping the time as effective as possible. I don't want to just sort of sound as an egoistic person. We are a group of persons who worked together for a long, long time, especially Gülseren helped me a lot, who is now not here. She's in somewhere doing a juristic business in Sinop. In the first papers, we, of course, now know where we are. We are in Trakezion, in the southeastern part of Izmir, and our main working areas are Tire, as most of the speakers said, Ödemiş, then we have Birgi, then we have Kiraz, what Ali mentioned, then we have Beyda. So these are the townships, the modern townships of Izmir, where we today focus as Kayser Valley. Up to now, there is almost nobody who really worked on the chronology of this valley. We have some, of course, knowledge about it, but nobody has been compiled a chronology for the Kayser Valley except Roosevelt in his book 2009, where he classified chronology as first before the 12th century as Iron Age, then early Kayser Valley period, which is 12th to 7th century. Then we have 7th to 6th century in the time of Croesus. Then we have late archaic period here in the late 6th century. Then we have early Hellenistic period from 3rd century to the Middle Roman period, 3rd century AD. Then we have a province in the time of Diocletian and Byzantine period. And after the Byzantine period, around 600 to 15th century, the long medieval period for Kayser Valley. When we check the literature, some evidence about the society, the social structure, military, economy, resources, agriculture, livestock, ceramics, textiles, luxury goods, commerce, religion, cults and place of worship, fine arts, architecture, some music, and the language in Kayser Valley. But as I said, the literature is extremely limited. So far, the most spectacular finds in terms of archaeology were the ones which are belonging to the Lydian period, especially the ones here we see in the Museum of Ödemiş, which are also published by Roosevelt, those Lydian period finds, especially this one with the Lydian script in the Museum of Ödemiş. And has been transcribed. And also what we know from the region is archaeologically the numismatic. We know some coins from the region, which are one earliest coinage in Asia Minor, in whole world even, that we know from the publication. So we have two things from the Lydian periods in the region. The first, as I said, this reliefs or funerary sculpture, as well as some coins. So with our team, we studied the museum material in Kayser Valley, first of all, from the Museum of Afyonkarahisar, from Ödemiş, Tire, İzmir, and Kütahya. And I would like to present you our results from those studies. The first result will be about the tumulus, the tumuli in the Kayser Valley. And now we see here a relief from a tumulus in the region of Kayser Valley. But most of the tumuli in the region are unpublished.